case questions. A case question is a fun, intriguing and active interviewing tool used to evaluate the multidimensional aspects of the candidate. What firms look for? Consultants spend a great deal of their time on the road or at the client's site. They work in a small teams and are sometimes put in charge of the groups of the client's employee. Often, consultants work under the great pressure in turbulent environments while dealing with seemingly unmanageable problems. It takes a certain type of the personality to remain cool under pressure, to influence the client without being condescending, and to be both articulate and analytical at the same time. The business of the consulting really is the renting of the brains, packaged and delivered with the engaging and confident personality. As you work through the case, the interviewer is asking, is this candidate relaxed, confident and mature, a good listener, a good communicator, engaging, enthusiastic and intellectually curious, exhibiting strong social and personal presentation skills, asking insightful and problem questions, able to determine what's truly relevant, organizing the information effectively, and developing a logical framework for analysis, stating assumptions clearly, comfortable discussing the multifunctional aspect of the case, trying to quantify his response at every opportunity, displaying both business sense and common sense, thinking creatively, rolling with the punches, defending himself without being defensive. Case preparation. Case questions can be made simple through our preparation and practice. I never like to equate an interview with a test, but they are similar in that the more you prepare, the better you'll do. Maybe you have experienced the feeling of being so prepared for an exam that you can't wait for the professor to hand it out, so you can leap right through it. Case questions are the same. Firms look to see whether you have that leap right through it look in your eyes. It's called confidence. Confidence. Some of my students, even after they got the job, would come into my office and ask me to give them a case. They loved doing cases. To them, it was no different from working a crossword puzzle. They loved the intellectual challenge and they learned something every time they did one. One of the best ways to learn how to answer a case is to write your own case. You are basically re-engineering the process. You need to think of the structure plus the answers to all the questions that an interviewer would ask. Interview evaluation forms. Every firm has its own individual evaluation form. However, what they look for is the same. Some are broken down into the analytics, structure, quant acumen, and good use of data, communication, eye contact, articulation, listening, asking probing questions, and note layout, and personal, enthusiasm, self-confidence, network, original thought, and intellectual curiosity. To use one example, the Brain and Company interview evaluations form is broken down into three areas: value addition, client or team, reality check, plus a final summary rating. You are rated 1 to 5 in several categories under these areas, with 5 being the highest score. Value addition. Under value addition, you have 5 categories: structures, problem solving, business judgment, quant skills, creativity, and drive to result. 80 or 20 plus are 80 over 20 plus are a final overall value addition score. Client or team. Here also are five categories plus a summary score. The five areas are drive or achievement, team skills, communications, professionalism, and leadership. Reality check. Under this heading, the interviewer is asked to answer the three questions. Is this the person interested in the brain? In Bain? Bain, yeah, BCG, Bain. McKinsey, Bain. Would you have this person on your team? The airport test, and would you pass on or give an offer to this person? Summary. Finally, you get an overall interview rating. In the first two sections, there are aspects of the interviewer to write comments under two headings, strengths and weakness, and topics to test in next round. I don't care who's given the case, whether it's Amazon, Pepsi, BCG, McKinsey, they all look for the same four things: structure of thought, confidence level, communication skills, and going beyond the expected answer, creativity. Whoa. Types of case questions. Case questions generally fall into one of the three major categories. Back of the envelope questions, which are often called market sizing questions, factor questions, and business care questions. It's quite common to find a market sizing question enclosed within the larger business case questions. Whether fun or frustrating, all case questions are a valuable learning experiences, right? The market sizing questions. Base your answer on logic and assumptions. Structure. Listen to question, then label the case. Population-based, household, or preposterous. Ask clarifying the questions only if you don't understand the question or terminology. Lay out your structure first and the steps you'll need to answer the question, then go back through it with the numbers. Assumptions. Don't worry if your assumptions are off. The interviewer is more interested in your thought processes than whether your assumptions are correct. If your assumptions are way off, they will tell you, otherwise they will let it go. Base your assumptions on some sort of the logic, otherwise the interviewer might press you on how you drew that conclusion. You can group the several assumptions into one number. For example, the 20% takes into account X, Y, and Z. Mass. Estimate or round off the numbers to make calculation easier. Write all numbers down. Answer. Review the final answer to see if that number makes sense. If not, say so, and pick up a number that makes more sense. That's right. Market sizing questions. Market sizing questions surface all of the time and can be found during any round of interviewing. Sometimes it's a standalone question, but most often it's embedded in the larger case. When I hear the market sizing question, I like to label it. Is it a population-based question, a household question, or a preposterous question? Regardless of the type of the market sizing question, your answer should be based on logic and assumptions. Geometry, right? Yes. There will be instances when your assumptions are wrong. Sometimes the interviewer will correct you. Other times, she will let it go. The interviewer is more interested in your logic and thought process than whether your assumptions are spot on. If you are still concerned, you can always say, I am not that familiar with this market, so if my assumptions are off, please correct me. 90% of the time, the interviewer will tell you not to worry about it. However, everything you say has the potential to be questioned. Be ready to defend your assumptions as they should be based on some type of the logic. If you just pull them out of the air, you are risking the interviewer aggressively challenging your assumptions and your credibility, of course. During a market sizing case, you don't get a chance to ask questions. You can ask a question only if you don't understand something. If they rattle off a string of the initials, industry, jargon or slang, and you are not sure what they mean, ask. You don't lose points for asking clarifying questions. These questions are tough enough to answer even when you do understand all the information. When I go into the market sizing question, I've already memorized several key facts and numbers. I don't want to be caught flat-footed, and I don't want to pull numbers out of the air that are going to be difficult to work with. I want numbers that are going to be easy, numbers that I'm familiar with, so I can do calculation with confidence. Of course. This is how it is. Right. Here are some key numbers that you should memorize. US population is 320 million. Life expectancy of an American is 80 years. Wow. Even distribution between the ages. So there is the same number of 2-year-old as 72 years old. So we know that this is not true, but in a case like this, it's fine to assume that 4 million people per age group. 80 million per generation, 100 million US households. Regardless of where you are interviewing, you should know these key facts for your country or region. Also, don't use your friends as a sample population. Chances are you are at the elite university and your friends are unlikely to represent the general population. And remember to use easy numbers, easy the numbers you can divide and multiply without much problem. As they give you the question, write everything down, determine and label the question. Next, ask questions only if you don't understand the questions or terminology. Finally, lay out your structure, then go back through it and fill in the numbers. That way, you get a second bite at the apple as you work through the problem again. Base your assumptions on some sort of logic, and take advantages of grouping assumptions together. You can say something like the 20% takes into account X, Y, and Z. Right. Population-based questions. Population-based questions are often broken down by generation, 0 to 20, 21 to 40, 41 to 60, and 61 to 80, or 80 million people per generation. To calculate a subset of each generation, use 4 million people per year. Thus, the number of people in their 20s would be 40 million, 4 million people times 10 years. Sometimes you might want to break it down by men and women. 50 over 50 split. How many new smartphones were sold in the US last year? Make assumptions and break the population down by generation. Determine the number of the cell phones in each generation. Calculate the number or percentage of the smartphones out of each generation's number of the cell phones. You may want to draw a chart to show how well organized you are and how logically you think. It also makes it easier for an interviewer to follow your thought process. Review the final answer to see if that number makes sense. If it does not make sense, tell the interviewer that you think that a number seems high and pick a new number that seems more reasonable. You don't have to go back through the process again. They know your processes. It was just that one of your assumption was off. Assumptions. 320 million Americans. Life expectancy of 80 years. even distribution among their ages. I'm going to divide it into generations 0 to 20, 21 to 40, 41 to 60, and 61 to 80. That means 80 million people per generation. Kids 0 to 12 or 50 million American children don't own cell phones. Out of the remaining 28 million kids, I'll assume that 20 million have a cell phone. Out of that 20 million, I'll assume that 10 million have a smartphone. These are older kids and they are technologically, technology driven. Reason through your numbers for each generation and fill in the chart as you go along. Zero to 20, population 80 million, number of cell phones 20 million, number of smartphones 10 million. From 21 to 40, population 80 million, number of cell phones 60 million, number of smartphones 50 million. The from 41 to 60. Population is 80 million. Number of cell phones is 60 million. Number of smartphones are 50 million. From 61 to 80, population is 80 million. Number of cell phones are 60 million. And the number of smartphones is 40 million. The number of cell phones is 200 million. Number of smartphones is 150 million. We came up with 150 million smartphones in the US. However, the question called for the number of smartphones sold in the US last year. The average cell phone contract is 2 years, but with the rising cost of the cell phones and less impressive feature upgrades, I'd assume that people are holding onto their phones longer. I'm also going to assume that more people are buying refurbished phones. Taking all that into account, that means that 75 million are eligible. I'd assume 80% will upgrade to a new model. That means 60 million. Open parenthesis, 75 times 0.80. Parentheses will upgrade. I'd also assume that 20% of the 25 million, 20 to 150 million over two regular cell phone users eligible for the an upgrade will switch to a smartphone, which equal 5 million. That's 65 million smartphones were sold last year. Now, you may not agree with all my assumptions, but as long as you can follow my logic, I am fine.